In this video, we will talk in depth about impact testing for metals that follow standards like ASTM E23 and ISO 148. But first, what is impact testing and why is it important? Forget gradual forces. Imagine a punch multiplied by a million. Through impact testing, materials are exposed to sudden and severe loading or strain rates by means of abrupt impact or strikes. This process enables engineers to predict the performance of materials under extreme conditions, such as crashes, explosions, or other severe impacts that might encounter in real-life scenarios. Stick around till the end of the video, where I will take you through an important parameter that is essential for materials used in low-temperature applications. The goal of the impact testing is to evaluate properties like resilience, toughness, strength, ductility under intense pressures induced by high-velocity impacts, which can lead to shock waves propagating through the material. Ductility refers to how much material can stretch and deform before breaking like a rubber band, while brittleness describes the tendency to crack or shatter more like glass. Unlike routine tensile tests that impose near static loading, the rapid strain rates generated through impact machines like drop weight tests reveal substantially different material behaviors. By quantifying metrics like the energy absorbed by the specimen during fracture, impact testing provides unique insights into mechanical performance that inform smarter material selection. We'll review some of the specific methods and equipment behind different impact test configurations. The most widely used configuration for impact testing is undoubtedly the Charpy impact test. This test employs a weighted pendulum hammer that is raised to a set height and then released to swing down and strike a notched sample at the base. When preparing samples for Charpy impact testing, strict protocols must be followed to ensure valid, repeatable results. We will walk through the key specimen dimensions, machining methods, finishing techniques, and handling procedures step by step. The ASTM standard first defines sample geometry. Charpy specimen shall measure 55 mm by 10 mm by 10 mm, with the longest edge typically aligned parallel to the final rolling direction of the test material. The specific sizing and orientation aids fracture analysis during the impact load. If enough material is not present, there is also a requirement for sub-size specimen, as shown here. Specimen production starts with sectioning a 55 mm length from the test plate via cutting or through a bandsaw. This undergoes face milling to achieve the 10 by 10 mm cross-section before all sides get ground to a maximum surface roughness of 4 micron RA. At this stage, we have established the fundamental shape. A V-notch broach tool is used to cut a notch with a radius of 0.25 mm, which concentrates the force during impact test. Alternately, EDM wire cut is also used to get the required notch dimensions. The face of a notch requires additional surface grinding and polishing to 2 microns for optimal propagation of the crack. Only with properly finished faces can we validate notch dimensions. An optical profile projector verifies this 0.25 mm root radius and the depth of the notch as per the standard dimensions. With geometry fully validated, identification markings get etched onto the far ends of the sample where allowable. ID marks should only be made on the 10 mm square faces or on the top side of the specimen when placed on the anvil, and should be at least 10 mm away from the center line of the notch. With that, our Charpy test specimens are ready to undergo testing. Before that, let us focus on the equipment and specifications for it. The key components include the sturdy frame, a pendulum arm weight, an anvil to support the test material positioned horizontally in the line of impact. The pendulum contains a striker with a standard 8 mm radius, with the other dimensions as per standard shown here. An optional 2 mm striker can also be used. The machine is bolted on a strong concrete foundation to keep it stable. The bearings that allow the pendulum to swing can introduce friction, reducing the pendulum speed and thus the energy available to fracture the specimen. As the pendulum swings through the air, it encounters air resistance, which can also reduce the energy available for fracturing the specimen. The analog scale and displays are compensated for these frictional losses. These values should not exceed 0.75% of the total capacity of the machine. The position of the pendulum when hanging freely should be within 2.5 mm from the test specimen. The impact velocity of the pendulum should also be kept within 3 meter per second to 6 meter per second. The mechanism to release the pendulum should also not cause any sudden jerks or impulses. The sample is placed on an anvil having a span of 40 mm with a radius of 1 mm and a support angle of 90 degrees. The sample should be placed such that the midpoint of the sample is within 0.25 mm of the midpoint between the anvil. Once this is checked, centering tongs are used so as to align the sample on the anvil. By analyzing the initial and final height of the pendulum, the energy lost by the pendulum, or in other words, the energy absorbed by the sample, is known. The Charpy test provides data about a material's toughness and ductility. The final reading from the testing has units of joules, which is the energy absorbed by the sample. A lower value of joules signifies a more brittle material, and vice versa for ductile materials. While methods like ISOT, drop weight, and other configuration also serve useful applications, this video will focus solely on the Charpy impact test, the best practices, precautions to be taken, and more. But first, let's look at some of the precautions that are to be taken while performing this test. The first is a sample orientation. The rolling process elongates the grains in the direction of rolling, creating a preferred orientation. This orientation affects how cracks initiate and propagate when the material is subjected to impact loading. In Charpy impact test, samples taken perpendicular to the rolling direction, is also called as the transverse direction, may exhibit different impact values when compared to the longitudinal direction. This may not always be lower than the rolling direction, but depends on the material characteristics. The second precaution that needs to be taken is the direct verification of the machine. At least once a year, the impact machine is to be checked for dimensions of the pendulum, anvil, and its height. This is called direct verification because we are checking the dimensions directly. Also, every year, samples from NIST are tested as per ASTM E23, and these results are sent back to ensure that the values that you provide meets within their tolerance of the reference values. This again ensures that there is no deviation in the type of testing that you carry out. The third precaution is in the preparation itself. While preparing specimens, there could be heat induced from machining that could impact the local properties of the material, thus influencing your end result. Finally, the notch dimension is absolutely critical, as this is where the entire crack propagation occurs. If the notch is not prepared according to standards, the initiation of the crack may not be efficient, thus leading to false values. We will also look at some low temperature applications in the final section, but all you need to know is that while testing specimens at low temperatures, it is important to move these specimens from your liquid bath within 5 seconds, as the environmental temperature may impact the final temperature of the test specimens. Proper calibration of the thermocouples also have to be done to maintain accuracy of the liquid bath. Now, let's look at some factors that affect your impact results. Microstructures containing high fractions of ductile phase, like large ferrite grains, austenite, or substantially tempered martensite, enable more plastic deformation. This increases the fracture energy required. Brittle faces directly lower values. Next, the sample orientation itself. Anisotropic materials display significant directionality properties. Crack propagation change when it's a longitudinal direction while compared to the transverse direction. The next factor is the pendulum energy rating. Most impact machines are rated at 300 joules, although there are lower and higher ratings. up to 500 joules as well. Low-rated machines using a lighter hammer are unable to exceed the impact strength of very tough materials. Thus will lead to false readings, like especially in the higher end. Heavier weights ensure complete breakage, measuring the full capacity. The next factor is the hammer radius. Minor deviations in the hammer radius can affect the contact stresses and thus gives you different impact values. Special baths are used to maintain cryogenic temperatures using liquid nitrogen around minus 196 degrees Celsius. For cryogenic readings, the test specimen is usually submerged within the liquid nitrogen bath for over 5 minutes before testing to ensure uniform cooling. And testing engineers must ensure that the samples are placed in the anvil and struck within 5 seconds of removal from the bath. Now let's look at how we interpret impact test results. The primary output of interest from Charpy test is the absorbed impact energy required to fracture the specimen. Higher values indicate better resistance to crack propagation. Analyzing the appearance of the fracture surface also provides telling qualitative insights. Ductile shear lips and microvoid coalescence reveal substantial plastic tearing has occurred prior to breakage. This aligns with decent energy absorption. Meanwhile, smooth, brittle transglandular cleavage patterns signal a lack of plastic deformation that is confirmed in the quantitative result, which is hardly in lower double digits or single digit values. The broken specimens are impacted for lateral expansion, which gives a quantifiable value for this amount of ductility. The first is in the automotive sector, where the vehicle crashworthiness design relies extensively on Charpy impact values. The next application is in the aerospace sector. Aircraft designers face precarious heat gradients and dynamic fatigue-inducing cracks. Judicious material selection using Charpy testing ensures tolerance of minor damage without catastrophic failure. Moving on to the next application, we head into the defense sector. Armor plates are tested for their impact energy to absorb the energy coming from high-speed projectiles. The next application will be in low-temperature and valve industries. Safe design of low-temperature valves and pipe networks components rely deeply on Charpy impact analysis and their values at low temperature. We will now look into a special section dedicated to low-temperature applications. This is what is called as the ductile-to-brittle transition, and this particular example is focused on stainless steel. The ductile-to-brittle transition is nothing but the change in material behavior from ductile, which is more like a elastic state, to a brittle state. And the temperature at which this property changes is known as the transition temperature. Stainless steel 304 is an austenitic grade and one of the most commonly used stainless steels, which comprises mainly of 18% chromium and 8% nickel. The composition provides excellent corrosion resistance and good mechanical properties across a wide temperature range. Due to its FCC crystal structure, SS304 generally exhibits better ductility and lower DBTT, also called as the ductile-brittle transition temperature, compared to ferritic or martensitic grades. The presence of impurities such as sulfur and phosphorus can increase the susceptibility to embrittlement. Its toughness can decrease, raising concerns in cryogenic applications. In performing a series of impact tests, a curve of the impact energy versus test temperature is drawn. Here, we see that at 0 degrees Celsius, the impact energy is above 175 joules. And while reducing the test temperature, the values gradually reduce as well. At a particular temperature range between minus 20 to minus 30 degrees Celsius, we see a steep drop, which is where we see the ductile to brittle transition temperature. If you have more questions about Charpy testing, let me know in the comments below. There are other complementary tests that are done along with this impact test, which you can find in our channel. And this talks about tensile and hardness testing. Subscribe for more content related to testing. See you in the next video.